I hand over the dice to you now.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. And I guess we can begin.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, ma'am. You just you begin.
Sure. So let me first introduce the topic. Like, we will be discussing about the psychological impact of COVID-19. And meanwhile, I'll also share a PPT alongside so that it's easier for the audience to gauge what we are talking about. Why we have chosen this particular topic in today's time is we can see that there's a need of hour, and all of us are should be well equipped, you know, with all kind of psychological tools, and we should all be mentally prepared to handle the pandemic in a better way. In future, we are also going to require this defense mechanism to
मैंने आपको भी मैसेज नहीं कनेक्ट हो गया मैसेज दिया ना आपको मैंने भी
हेलो
हाँ जी या
आई नो आई थॉट यू आर टॉकिंग टू मी आई गेस यू आर टॉकिंग टू समवन एल्स ओके सो हियर आई एम शेयरिंग द लाइक आई वुड शेयर द पीपीटी विद यू ऑल इज दिस विजिबल जस्ट लेट मी नो Okay. Is the PPT visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, okay. So, so here goes the first slide, and I hope everybody is comfortable. Let me go through the run through the PPT once, explain the concepts, and henceforth, if you have any question. We will take the question at the end of the session and I'll answer all of it. So just keep note of the queries that occur to you so that we can finish the webinar on time. So we first talk about the psychological impact of COVID-19 and why I have chosen this very subject to discuss here at this minute. Because I believe that life instinct and death instincts are two binding forces, two pushing forces rather, that forces us towards life, towards any sort of decision we make. And I'm not sure if everybody knows what thanatos and eros are. As a psychologist and also as a believer of pride in family, pride in psychoanalysis philosophy, I would like to bring your attention to this fact that we have, all of us, in fact, all kind of living organisms have two forces. One is life instinct, the other is death instinct, or the pull towards death also, wherein eros is the life instinct that pushes us towards life. That is what makes us survive. That is how we survive all kinds of complications in past. Thanatos, of course, is kind of, you know, finishing off. Like, even when, let us take an example, I don't know, I want to make it sound a little more simpler. If you take example of a small child who is scheduled to go out to the playground and play, because it's time of time to play outside, but then tomorrow he also has a test which he has to attempt and he needs to study because he wants to score good marks. Now the child has two options. One, he can either skip, you know, it's a pull kind of thing. He also wants to play, go out and play, and then he also has to sit and study. Either of it will win. So he will have to choose in between. So it's a conflicting situation, even for a small child. So if he is very, very strongly wanting to score and achieve something, he might, you know, skip the game today. That is life instinct. And in the process, simultaneously, something he has to let go of. So all of us are pulled amongst these two extremes. And COVID-19 is one such thing. Leela sir, there is so many noise. I mean, I guess everybody... Hello? Maya ma'am, can you please... Everybody are muted, please. I can hear so many noises in the background.
Maya madam.
Hello, yes sir.
मैडम सबको म्यूट कर दीजिए एक्सेप्ट मैडम को और मुझे, बाकी सबको म्यूट कर दीजिए.
सर वैसे सब म्यूट है,
आवाज आ रही बैकग्राउंड से.
ओके मैम, आकांक्षा तिवारी अनम्यूट है.
ओके आई एम सॉरी टू डू दिस बट एक्चुअली आई कुड हियर सो मेनी नॉइजेस, आई वाज नॉट एबल टू कंसंट्रेट. ओके fine. So let us discuss COVID-19. This is another life event, not very pleasant one, very threatening in fact, but still an event in our life, and we'll have to win it. We'll have to come out successfully so that we can live and lead a better life in future. So when we are saying pandemics, or you know, few of the students that some last, I guess 15 days back, I was discussing things and they were like, what is the difference between pandemic and epidemic and why you always keep referring to COVID-19 as a pandemic? So before I get to the psychological factor that is affecting us, let us first get a very clear idea about what is epidemic and pandemic. If you see in the picture, there is on the top of it, there is one block showing endemic occurrences, wherein the diseases occur locally, confined to a particular area, and they're not very widespread. So sometimes we call it as, you know, tropical disease, though fatal in nature. Sometimes many individuals get affected in the one go and it claims many lives. It is epidemic, but it is not globally spread. At least not to the same degree to all the countries at one go simultaneously. Then there are sporadic occurrences wherein the even this viruses or bacteria keep attacking humans or other animals periodically. They reoccur, they are unpredictable, they are scattered, they're not confined to one area, but those areas are also not interlinked in a way. And then comes pandemic. So pandemic is an epidemic that will also affects mankind in a large number, claims many lives, and very global in nature, doesn't follow or remain in a territory. So that is how. So now we will discuss three or four points about COVID-19. So coronavirus disease, COVID-19, is an infectious disease caused by newly discovered coronavirus. We all are so very scared of this disease because we do not know how to stop it. So it's not the disease itself, it's the uncertainty that is putting us inside locked doors. We do not know how to fight it with the help of medication. We do not have any vaccination. We are not certain till date, you know, of all 100 ways how it gets spread. So anything that is unknown, that is very strange, that is proving to be more powerful than us because we are not able to control it, it's scary. So that is instilling fear in human race. So this virus, till now, as per the guidelines of WHO, the virus that causes COVID-19 is mainly transmitted through droplets generated when an infected person coughs, sneezes, or exhales. The droplets are heavy, so that's why it's not airborne. They fall on the floor quickly. That is why, you know, it's on and again, we are being cautioned that please keep your shoes outside the home. Please wash your hands. Do not take things directly to home. Please make sure that you do not touch surfaces everywhere because you become more prone to getting infected. The most important factor in preventing the spread of the virus locally is to empower the citizens, and for the citizens, it's about, you know, abiding by the government norms, government directives that is being issued. So in our country, we have been asked to keep indoors, don't meet strangers, don't have no handshakes, wear masks, don't go out, don't eat outside. If we follow all this, are we like protected against COVID-19 100%? Maybe not, but we can always keep this infection at bay and we need to empower ourselves. So what we need to do at this hour is keep following those directives issued, being issued by the government. Keep training people around us. Not all of us in our neighborhood is educated or aware or cautious to the same degree. So if you want to save the society, it's our responsibility to train people, counsel people, help them understand what it is, how it gets spread, and why we should not be falling prey to it. If you see the corner picture, generally, whatever, maybe you know, all of us would love to spend time inside in this summer. This it's scorchingly hot outside. But because we are being asked to keep inside, we are not willing to keep inside. We want to go out in this sun. We want to, you know, suffer all the heat stroke and other things, but we are not very willing to keep inside. Just because ma'am, please unmute the participant. I guess there are more participants who are not muted. So this COVID-19 phase has forced us to keep inside. And when we say, okay, fine, now it's like many of us also keep preaching the other person, like, fine, you have gotten this opportunity to remain inside. Why don't you fulfill your hobbies? Do you always wanted to spend some time alone? You always wanted to be, you always enjoyed seclusion. You wanted to be isolated. Please understand, when the confinement is defined by us, by our own self, we enjoy it. Right now, whatever instructions we are supposed to follow is forced on us. Then people can, you know, still abide by short confinement. When it becomes, when it gets longer, when it's for long hours, long days, it becomes very difficult to abide by and keep our sanity intact. If it is defined, suppose everybody knew that, okay, fine, in this many days we are going to go out, we can, you know, reclaim our business, the economy will not suffer, and we will be, you know, be able to meet our friends. It's for this duration only. Then it would have been very easy. But right now, because it is not defined, the undefined lockdown is problematic. People, they live in uncertainty, and then they live in fear, because one fine day when they go out and when they, you know, they come back, suppose somebody has just had a kind of indigestion, which the person would otherwise also suffer. But they get panicky, like what's happening to us. Sometimes, you know, in some families, we are all blessed with technology. Right now, you know, all the participants who are here in this webinar, we are enjoying intellectual interaction. So we are not suffering that feel or the stigma or, you know, being aloof, being pushed in a corner. So we are learning. We are accessing many courses. Think of those fellow beings who do not have access to any such resources. They are running short of all the resources. They don't have adequate food. They do not know what they are going to do tomorrow. They don't have savings. They do not. They have lost their jobs. So these are unpleasant consequences of this particular life event. So the COVID-19 has forced us in separation, in seclusion, and quarantine is not isolation. Those people who are drawing analogy and drawing them, you know, explaining them as in synonymous, please understand, being quarantined is like you, self-imposed quarantine is also fine. Isolation is like, suppose there is some restriction, somebody is there to take care of you and keep checking you. Quarantined is you are free, but you're not free. You can live your life, but you're not supposed to move around. It's difficult. It's difficult because you are not being isolated because you're infected. Or maybe, you know, the full family is sometimes getting quarantined. Sometimes you just show that you have high temperature and you've just returned from somewhere. Because you have a travel history, you have to be quarantined till the time your test results come. And this particular phase, this uncertain phase, is particularly problematic. And that causes a lot of trouble. Those quarantined people, the health workers who are taking care of them, the support staff, the cleaning staff, the children, everybody who is quarantined and who is isolated and who are restricted on movement suffered this, they will always report high frequency of exhaustion, high amount of exhaustion. They will kind of remain detached with what's happening around them. Sometimes the anxiety level also goes high. They get anxious by very small happenings. They are very irritable at moment. You suggest them something. Those kids, teenagers particularly, who were supposed to report to school back after the vacation, they had many plans. Those kids who were appearing for class 11th and 12th examinations, who wanted to do something in summers, they had huge plans about their career and all. Everything is stuck. Everything is at hold. So they get very irritable, and the family members fail to understand, like, when they don't they were supposed to go to school, they did not enjoy school. Now they're not supposed to go to school, and still they are so irritated. Why? Because they were not wanting to report to school because of tight schedule, but they still wanted to go to school because they were to meet their friends. They had their own plans. Some people suffer insomnia. Some people suffer indecisiveness. Indecisiveness is otherwise also a very prominent feature of people who are under stress. So concentration level goes poor. Small children, they sometimes, throw a tantrum and they are very reluctant to abide by the norms. The adults, those who fall in this group of early adults or young adults who are aging in the age ranges between, say, 25 to 35 or 40, they are also finding it very difficult to stay inside because they have to go back and take care of their businesses. They have to go back and report to work. Not every industry, all the industries cannot afford to make their people and give their employee this opportunity or leisure of working from home, because there are manufacturing units which need meet people constantly in field. So, and then what would happen is they start, once this lockdown is lifted, they also may start, then also, they may keep avoiding responsibilities. Sometimes they would escape some work. Their work performance will deteriorate because they'll go out of practice. So quarantine people, because they are day in and day out, they are dealing with this crisis. They are dealing with similar kind of stress. They are dealing with people around them who are suffering. Those people are supposed to take care of people who are in pain throughout the day. They consume all their energy in dealing with people and handling other people. So they also tend to suffer in long run. So we are discussing, I'm addressing you all through this webinar right at this minute, so that we can help others, those who are suffering, like those who are survivors, those whom we are labeling as corona warriors, who are taking care of others. So there are psychological sufferings come with different frequency and different degree. There are four categories we will be discussing in this webinar. We will be discussing four categories of psychological suffering. One is prolonged suffering. The other one is intense suffering. Third is associated suffering. And fourth is social suffering. Under this four title, we will be discussing how psychologically people get affected. So what is prolonged suffering? If you read the caricature, they have other synonyms like extended, protracted, lengthy, drawn out kind of thing. What are the symptoms? Let's focus on symptoms. This PPT will be shared with you later. Maybe all of you can contact Sage University to get hold of this PPT. But let me explain here. So the symptom is sadness. After being in confinement for long, or after addressing people pain for long duration, or maybe when you yourself are tired and you have been handling cases since long, the symptoms that start showing after some time is like sadness. You lose hope. People tend to lose hope. People tend to get fatigued very, very quickly. There is this guilt of not being able to save someone, those doctors, those health workers, despite trying so hard, keeping so much of patience, they still are not able to save lives. So that kind of instill guilt in them. they relive the trauma again and again. It's like any other PTSD syndrome. When the traumatic situation is over, still people relive those scenes because it is part of their life. It has ingrained so deep. The fear of contamination, because you know, everyday news we find out people who are a health worker and some of them get infected. They had been found positive, so this fear of contamination also sometimes gets settled in. Irritable and started, they are either, you know, very irritable. You cannot talk to them at many point. They do not take suggestions very kindly. And many a times you can notice that they get started in a very small event, like something falls down and then they get startled because they are lost in their thoughts. Most of the time, these people who are projecting these symptoms are generally lost in thoughts, and those thoughts are pertaining to the past of suffering of other people. Next is intense suffering. In intense suffering, people start reporting non-specific physical ailment. Like they would say, I'm not feeling good. When you say not feeling good means what? They don't know. They suffer aches, body aches. They complain of body aches, you know, sometimes headaches, sometimes stomach ache, but with no physical reason, practically. Appetite and memory loss is very common feature, wherein, you know, after prolonged exposure to some suffering or some kind of stress or some traumatic incidences, appetite loss is very common feature. Memory loss is also very commonly visible. Neglect and self-blame, they tend to neglect themselves. Because once, you know, this crisis, sometimes, you know, all of us have to keep alert about those health workers and our friends who are taking so much of pain to keep us safe these days. Later on, when this lockdown is lifted, when everything goes back to normal, please keep alert, keep watching your family members and friends and acquaintances who have been in this warrior group, that they should not fall in this particular category of self-blame. They keep blaming, you know, people sometimes blame themselves that we couldn't help, you know, somebody they wanted so desperately to help, some of their family member maybe, but they couldn't help. And then they start neglecting their own needs. They would not self-grooming, self-feeding also, you know, they stop feeding themselves and they get into grief. This grief, people who are very deep struck with grief, they lose all kind of hope in life. So that would eventually lead to depression and anxiety. So please take care that they should not get very deep into grief. This, as an, you know, this may cause impotency also at times. This is a psychosomatic syndrome when people go through stress at long. And then there are associated suffering. Associated means not directly related to the face or to the bacteria or to this incidence that's happening right now. Associated is like because of COVID-19, we are all in lockdown. This is one event. And then we might get under stress because of this. Not because we are affected by COVID-19. Not because we are locked down maybe. But because we were not able to go out and we were, you know, wanting to meet some of our relatives so desperately, we were not allowed to. We have not seen our family members for a long time. And we eventually get under stress, not because of any direct relation with this COVID-19 lockdown state. But we might as such, you know, suffer stress. There is depression. People who are inside for a longer time, not able, there are, think of those people who are stuck somewhere outside the country, somewhere outside their hometown, wherein they do not have any support system, wherein they do not have job, or they do not know how the future would look like. And then, you know, facing such kind of trauma alone may cause depression. Sometimes after one is through with this kind of stress and this kind of isolation, the codependency is again a very prominent feature that has been witnessed in people who have suffered trauma. Codependency is either, you know, you get dependent on some drugs or on alcohol or on some person for that matter. Suicidal behavior, one of the psychological effect that, you know, one of the psychological syndrome people have witnessed in those who suffer PTSD is, you know, instinct to, or maybe repeated attempt to commit suicide. Psychosomatic pathology, sometimes, you know, you are so much under anxiety, you fear getting contaminated, you don't want to, but then you think that, you know what, if you get affected, you want to save people, but you know you cannot save people. So after that, that consumes a huge part of energy. So when you are through with that, when you are drained of your energy, then psychosomatic pathology may also start showing off. Then there comes social suffering, because somebody is one, you know, we see this on and again around us these days. It's very frequent observation, like when people are diagnosed or maybe just doubted with COVID-19 positive test results that they are infected, people try to avoid them. So psychosocial vulnerability of you know, being dissociated or being avoided, people won't talk, so there is this stigma of isolation. When and if you are infected, if you are positive, you don't have a family here, it's not only, you know, food and shelter is not the only thing. You also need company, you also need someone to ask how you are doing these days. People who are infected are kept at bay. They know that they are going through a very hard time. People around them also knowing that they are going through a very hard time, but they still do not approach them. So communal anguish sometimes takes place. People, you know, because they are confined to their own place, a small matter which otherwise would have been ignored by people may not get ignored that easily. People might, you know, start blaming each other. This communal fight takes place at times. Intolerance goes higher. Crime rate will go high. I'm very, very concerned, like, what after this lockdown is lifted, because many of us will be jobless, many of the industries will be closed down, many of the family would have lost their earning members, so there would not be any financial support. What happens to the crime rate then? This is one major concern that I keep thinking all the while, like, what do these people do once this lockdown is lifted? And during this lockdown, again, you know, sitting inside home, not everybody is so blessed to use their time creatively. Not everybody is so very productive. Not everybody is having access to resources wherein they can polish their skills. So what after this lockdown is lifted? A death toll is obviously, you know, everyday newspaper featuring few numbers. People just read numbers. Those who have not lost any family members or friends, they read numbers as number. Those who have lost someone very close from the family, maybe they do not know how to deal with it. You know, will this rising number, will this create numbness in our mental acceptance, like social acceptance? It might also cause social unrest, like as death toll rises high, people in panic may start traveling to their hometown without thinking that how much of danger they are putting in their family. So, you know, all these things are to be kept in mind. And we should also remember why I'm trying to underline, like, you know, like what may happen after this lockdown is if we do not keep patience. There are so many negative sides to it. We may lose calmness. We may lose the strength. People may, you know, stop sharing after some time. People do get selfish. People do start they cling to the resources available to them. There are so many around us who would not have enough resources to survive through for many more days, maybe in future. But then we also need to remember that if we are informed, if we are informed by reading, because we can read and understand and comprehend what's happening around us. This also wants this lockdown is responsibility to train people around you who are not so well read, so educated. Prepare them to fight the scarcity. Prepare them to survive, you know, support their life in a better way. हेलो
हाँ ठीक है मैडम को बोल देता हूँ, बोल रहा हूँ मैडम।
हेलो
मैडम। हेलो
यस सर।
मैडम जस्ट 3 मिनट्स आर रिमेन्स।
जस्ट 2 more slides आर देयर।
या या
सो वी नीड टू रिमेन सेफ, वी नीड टू बी रेडी टू fight COVID-19 as we have fought in past. There are so many, you can see that there is in, on the left hand side there are many more such epidemics being listed, wherein Spanish flu, swine flu, HIV and plague, this kind of epidemics we have survived in past also. So for the warriors and those survivors, my suggestion is resume old routine as soon as possible, practice relaxation exercises, meditation and yoga. Spend time in natural ambience if possible. Rest and compensate for sleep. Eat regularly and balanced meals. Please don't succumb to drugs and alcohols. And socialize through alternate means like social media, Instagram, Facebook, whatever you can manage and whatever you are preferring. And reflect on the meaning of life once this is over. For the whole society, my message is like, have social acceptance of the family members of those who have maybe, you know, they have lost someone in this COVID-19 crisis. Provide social assistance to the lower sector, weaker sector. Organize social congregations via social media. Please adopt to social counseling and counsel your community people so that they can survive better in future. Provide training to the weaker section wherein they don't have access to literature and academics at length. Here are the list of certain websites. You can access this later to, you know, ponder more, think and read, learn more about COVID-19 and the psychological crisis and how to handle those crises in a better way. Yes, sir. It's up to you now.
So thank you very much, madam, for this informative session and your valuable and precious time.